All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm asking oh so politely for your attention, please. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much for coming to the 9th annual Mesa Speech Night. Now, the brochure you got is a little bit of a Where's Waldo when it comes to typos. So it is the 9th annual Mesa Speech Night. We appreciate you coming tonight. My name's Jotham Oliver. I have been blessed to be working with these students and blessed to be working aside my colleagues, Carolyn Louie and Julie Schoenfeld. I just want to point out something that you don't see tonight. You parents probably have a decent idea of, I would hope to think, the amount of work that's gone into tonight. The amount of work that your students have put into memorizing a speech, sure, there's that. But then there's the, oh, I have to overcome and be on this stage in front of all of you. There's very few of you in this room that would come up on this stage and do what these kids are going to do tonight. And those of you that in this room that would do it, you're former students of mine. You don't get to see the progress. Deep breath, thank you. A lot of progress. I'll leave it at that. There's a lot of progress. From where they started with their speech to where they are tonight. You will leave this room amazed at the amazing talent that we have in front of us. When you give students a task of the impossible and they achieve it, what a gift a school is giving them. Having them memorize what is the capital of Nevada only has so much bang for his buck as being so amazing. Or knowing what the quadratic formula is. All those things are very important and content is important, but when schools give the ability for students to gain self-esteem and gain confidence, we're doing something right, in my opinion. The other thing that you don't see is community. You don't get to see these kids interacting day in and day out and supporting each other and cheering each other on. It builds a community and it is part of what we try to do and build in Mesa. And I think we're extremely successful. And that leads us to what we are. We are a community. We look around, there are friends, family, there are business owners, administrators, school board members. We are a community that is coming together for a cause in which we believe that these children, that this moment is important. And we are honored to be here to be a part of it. Listen and consider what these children have to say. And I'm not just talking about the eighth graders. Oh my gosh, buckle up what the eighth graders might have to say. You will hear the absurd. You will be challenged. You will, in many ways, I'm really just asking you consider what they have to say, that you listen to what they say. I'm not asking you agree with what they say, but instead what I'm asking is that you listen and consider, as we should in a community, as different as everybody as you look upon, as everybody is in this room, different unto another, that we are listening to them. Listen to your children. You're going to listen to Abraham Lincoln, Maya Angelou, Malala, and Chaplin with an underlining theme of unity. And that is what brings a community together. My students have challenged me to give a speech. There's my speech. But as Megan Barry is fond of saying, Jotham Oliver, they're not here to listen to you. They're here to listen to these students. We're going to listen for about 17 speeches or so. We'll have a strong 5-minute intermission, and then we'll come back and we'll finish our speeches. I am asking on bended knee. You have a cell phone. It should be on mute. It should be on vibrate or what have you. Please make sure you take care of your cell phone. One of my favorite moments ever in speech night, is we had Anna Plessinger up here. She's giving her speech, and her dad's cell phone went off. It was awesome. The look she gave her dad, it would kill anybody else. So anyways, please turn off your cell phones. Be considerate. If you could, wait until somebody's done to get up, use a bathroom. But again, we are going to have a break. Is there anything else I'm forgetting? Ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to begin the 9th Annual Mesa Speech Night. It is my honor to introduce you our first speaker, Emmett Lounsbury.
Hi, my name is Emmett Lounsbury. I am in 8th grade and have written my own speech. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands for. That sounds familiar, right? From kindergarten up until a few months ago, I haven't known what this has meant. I even said a few words wrong. Now, kindergartners to 3rd or 4th graders probably have no idea what the pledge means and are just reciting it from memory. Recently, I decided to take a deeper look at what I was saying. That first part I said from the pledge basically means, I promise loyalty to the country for which the flag stands for. Next, in the pledge, it says, one nation under God. I feel it is an odd statement to put here, because in the next part it says, indivisible with liberty and justice for all, where liberty means the state of being free with no judgment on one's way of life. It seems contradictory to say here, because it shouldn't matter what religion you believe in if liberty is being mentioned in the pledge. Pledging to one God violates our ability to live with freedom and no judgment on one's way of life. If I say the pledge a little differently, maybe it would sound like this. I promise loyalty to the country for which, to the United States of America, one nation under God, unable to be divided or separated with the state of being free, with no judgment on one's way of life, and right and fair behavior and treatment for all. We should add something about our community to the Pledge of Allegiance, honoring everyone around us and the land we live on. If we add something like this, it will be easier to relate to and achieve. We could add being able to make the right decisions to best help and support my community. If we add something in honor of our community, it provides an attainable goal to reach. If I add this part about our community, my other modified pledge, it is, I promise loyalty to the United States of America, one nation under God, unable to be divided or separated with the state of being free, with no judgment on one's way of life, and right and fair behavior and treatment for all, whilst being able to make the right decisions for my community. Since Mesa has been such a big influence on me in my middle school years, I decided to come up with a pledge to Mesa. I'm going to start off by explaining why I want to come up with a pledge to Mesa. I want to come up with a pledge to Mesa because I've been in Mesa since 6th grade. I started online in the COVID years. Being at home during the COVID years was difficult because I was alone. It was a lot harder to do online learning, and it got easier when I went in person because it's a lot easier to make connections in person. Being in person, along with the outings, brought me closer to Mesa as well, deepening those connections. Mesa has given me a community of friends, teachers, and peers. That is why I'm making a pledge to Mesa. The first thing I want to add to my Mesa pledge is justice. Something Mr. Oliver always says is what's fair in life is when you know the rules up front. Another thing I want to add is indivisible, which is unable to be divided or separated. Once you're in Mesa, you can never forget your experiences, even when in high school. I also want to add liberty, which I said is the state of being free with no judgment on one's way of life. Mesa is a community where you can really express yourself without the risk of getting laughed at. An example of this is speech night. You have to get up on a stage and perform a speech you've memorized or written. Also in Mesa, you need to be prepared, which is to be willing and able to do something. In Mesa, you need to be prepared for the outings and the weather on those outings. There was one trip this year where we went to the cold river with GLT, and the high for that trip was 3 degrees Fahrenheit. We stayed outside for a couple of hours, and because we were prepared, we didn't have to leave early. Endurance. The fact or power of enduring an unpleasant or difficult process or situation without giving way is a big thing in Mesa, because sometimes it's really cold, windy, rainy, or snowy, and you have to be able to tolerate it. The last thing I want to add to my Mesa pledge is patience, which is being able to accept or tolerate delays and problems without becoming annoyed or anxious. In Mesa, sometimes there's really long bus trips, and you have to sit on the bus constricted to your seat for 2 hours. With all that said, here's my pledge. I pledge to the Mesa community, I am prepared and patient, ready for what's to come, bringing endurance and liberty, indivisible, surrounding around justice. Thank you.
I'm Olivia Shaney, and I'm going to be doing Maya Angelou. Come, clad in peace, and I will sing the songs the Creator gave to me, when I and the tree and the stone were one. Before cynicism was a bloody sear across your brow, and when you yet knew, you still knew nothing, the river sings and sings on. There's a true yearning to respond to the singing river and the wise rock. So say, the Asian, the Hispanic, the Jew, the Catholic, the Native American, the Sioux, the Muslim, the French, the Greek, the Irish, the rabbi, the priest, the Sikh, the gay, the straight, the preacher, the privileged, the homeless, the teacher. They hear. They all hear the speaking of the tree. Today, the first and last of every tree speaks to humankind. Come to me here beside the river. Plant yourself beside me here beside the river. Each of you, descendant of some past untraveler, has been paid for. You, who gave me my first name. You Pawnee, Apache, and Seneca. You Cherokee Nation, who wrestled with me, then forced on bloody feet, who left me to the employment of other seekers, desperate for gain, starving for gold. You the Turk, the Swede, the German, the Scot, the Ashanti, the Yoruba, the Kerr, bought, sold, stolen. Arriving on a nightmare, praying for a dream. Here, root yourself beside me, and the tree planted by the river, which will not be moved. Either rock, either river, either tree, I'm yours. Your passages have been paid. Lift up your faces, you have a piercing need for this bright morning dawning for you. History, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived. And if faced with courage, need not be lived again. Lift up your eyes upon the day breaking for you. Give birth again to the dream. Women, children, men, take it into the palms of your hands. Mold it into the shape of your most private need. Sculpt it into the image of your most public self. Do not be wedded forever to fear, yoked internally to brutishness. The horizon leans forwards, offering you space to place new steps of change. Each new hour holds new chances for new beginnings. No less to Midas, to the mendicant, no less to you now than the master than them. Here on the pulse of this new day, you may have the grace to look up and out and into your sister's eyes, into your brother's face, your country, and say simply, very simply, with hope, good morning.
Oh, Mesa.
I'm Bryson Lounsbury. I'm in sixth grade, and I'm going to be doing the Gettysburg Address. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground, because the brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is for us, rather, to be dedicated here to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they here gave their last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from earth.
Hello? Hello? Okay. Hello, my name is Kai Drogo Cannon Steele, and this is my speech about creativity. Humans. We are all humans. And one thing I know for certain is that all humans are creative. Creativity is self-expression and defies who you are. So this speech will be about how I think schools diminish creativity. Now, there's a lot of disapproval of our education system because it seems like it hasn't changed to the current times or improved on for a long while. Creativity. Creativity is often one of these things mentioned in these conversations and is normally looked over. Can creativity mean different things to different people? How can we increase creativity in our students? The final big question is that, is the way our education system working diminishing students' creativity? I think a lot of people assume that creativity has one meaning, that you are either born with it or it must be developed. But that's wrong. Creativity is in everybody. Everybody uses it. Everybody, you need it in everybody, or else it basically defies you as a non-existent person. Creativity can be about imagination, self-expression, or scientific principles to solve problems. And yes, creativity, people can be more creative than others, but it's a skill some people possess more than others. My opinion, school isn't about memorizing facts and dates as they do in some subjects. We are motivated to color inside the lines and not be creative. For example, in math class, when you're solving a problem, the teacher always wants you to solve it in one way and not be creative to solve it in multiple ways. Also, the definition of a good student is someone who sits still, is quiet, and listens to their teacher. And if you know me, I am not that kind of person. I am a very energetic student, and normally during a class, I'll have to get up, stretch, or fidget. And normally, This is looked down upon by teachers because it can be caused as a distraction. Maybe it's time to change some of our classes. For instance, how we have ELA, math, social studies, and science. We can have classes like social skills or money management. In the real world, if you have no social skills, then you will probably have no friends, and this will lead to depression and anxiety. And same thing goes for money management. If you can't manage your money properly, then you will probably waste it on something that is unnecessary and not needed. And then you will be more depressed and even have even more anxiety. This is why schools need to change, and this is why we need to step in and change it.
Hello, my name is Gabriel Voter, and I am doing the Gettysburg Address. 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation, so conceived or so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note, nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is rather for us, the living, to be here dedicated to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to the cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people shall not perish from this earth.
Hi, I'm Mila Pierce, and I'm doing Maya Angelou. Come, clad in peace, and I will sing the songs the Creator gave to me. When I and the tree and the stone were one, before cynicism was a bloody sear across your brow. And when you yet knew, you still knew nothing. The river sings and sings on. There is a true yearning response to the singing river and wise rock. So say the Asian, Hispanic, the Jew, the African, the Native American, the Catholic, the Muslim, the French, the Greek, the Irish, the rabbi, the priest, the Sikh, the gay, the straight, the preacher, the privileged, the homeless, the teacher. They hear, they all hear. The speaking of the tree. Today is the first and last of every tree to speak to humankind. Come to me, here beside the river. Plant yourself beside me, here beside the river. Each of you, descendant of some passed on traveler, has been paid for. You who gave me my first name, you Pawnee, Apache, Seneca, you Cherokee Nation, who rested with me, then forced on bloody feet, left me to the employment of other seekers, desperate for gain, starving for gold. You, the Turk, the Swede, the German, the Scot, you, the Ashanti, Yoruba, Ku, bought, sold, stolen, arriving on a nightmare, praying for a dream. Here, root yourself beside me. I am the tree planted by the river, which will not be moved. I, the rock, I, the river, I, the tree, I am yours. Your passages have been paid for. Lift up your faces. You have a piercing need for this bright morning dawning for you. History, despite its wretching pain, cannot be unlived. But if faced with courage, need not to be lived again. Lift up your eyes upon the day breaking for you. Give birth again to the dream. Women, children, men, take it into the palms of your hands. Mold it into the shape of your most private need. Sculpt it into the image of your most public self. Lift up your hearts. Each new hour holds new chances for new beginnings. Do not be wedded forever, yoked internally into bruciousness. The horizon leans forward, offering a space to place new steps of change. Here, on this pulse of this fine day, you may have the courage to look up and out upon me. The rock, the river, the tree, your country. No less to Midas, to the mendicant, no less to now, to the mendicant then. Here, on this pulse of this fine day, you may have the courage, the grace to look up and into your sister's eyes, your brother's face, your country, and say simply, very simply, with hope, good morning.
Hi, my name is Avery Jordan, and I'm going to be doing the Gettysburg Address. 47 years ago, our fathers brought forth to this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. This is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground because the brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little know, nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they here gave their last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people shall not perish from this earth.
Unfortunately, some of you don't know me. So for the people that don't know me, I'm Ian Vanderveer. Food is a thing that everybody loves. Makes people happy. And man, do I love food. So it's just so juicy and delicious. There's some really good foods, like steak and ice cream. And there's some really bad foods, like kale and avocado. So in this speech, I'm going to talk about foods that are good and foods that are bad. Kind of like Mace's goods and bads. Steak is a good food. It's juicy and delicious. The best steak is a filet mignon that's medium rare. I only like a medium rare steak if it's from my house. That way, I know who cooked the steak. It's from a restaurant. I have no idea who cooked it and if they even made it medium rare. Now, probably one of the worst foods ever created is kale. A few years ago, people were obsessed with this kale stuff. They literally put it in everything. Kale literally tastes like bug spray. It's just so juicy and delicious. I mean, it's so bitter, I can't eat it. There are different types of kale. Sweet kale. Sweet kale is supposed to be sweet, but it's definitely not. It's bitter.
Hi, my name is Madison Legacy. So here's my speech. Life changes as you grow up and move on. My change, as many of you don't know, I lost my house to a fire. From everything to my clothes to all my personal belongings. The firefighters tried to save my house by breaking the windows to stop the spreading of the fire. My life is not all filled with bad things. There's good things too. I was put through this program called MESA, where there are people that have impacted my life with in the field trips with Tin Mountain and GLLT, where I have gone to so many places in New Hampshire and Lovell. I also got to go to Bryant Pond with my fellow MESA students and teachers. We all got to go face our fears of heights with the giant ladder and zip line. But that's not all. I have gone through so many situations, tough situations, and I have conquered them all. I have so many memories and hope for the future. There is the Sakuraza memory, where we all went down the Saku and did some fun activities with Tin Mountain. There's also another memory where with GLLT, where we went to Kizzy River Reserve, and I did a big group speech in front of everyone. I got feedback that I had never gotten. All those memories have done so much. Like, for example, I have had so many friends this year, and I hope and I appreciate you all. Audrey Hepburn once said, "Nothing is impossible. The word itself means I'm possible." Through it all, I have had my family right by my side. They have helped me and done so much. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Ryan True, and I'll be giving the Gettysburg Address. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth to this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we're engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation, so conceived, so dedicated, can long endure. We're met in a great battlefield of this war. We've come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who've here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow these grounds. Because the brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little know, nor long remember what we say here, but can never forget what they did here. It is for us the living, rather, to be dedicated to this unfinished work, which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these undead we take increased devotion to that cause for she gave that last full-measured portion. That we have a resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, and that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from earth.
I'm Avery Turner, and I'm doing Malala. Dear friends, on the 9th of October, 2012, the Taliban shot me on the left side of my forehead. They shot my friends, too. They thought the bullets would silence us, but they failed. And then, out of the silence, came thousands of voices. The terrorists thought that they could change our aims and stop our ambitions, but nothing changed in my life except this. Weakness, fear, and hopelessness died. Strength, power, and courage was born. I am the same Malala. My ambitions are the same, my hopes are the same, and my dreams are the same. I do not even hate the Talib who shot me. Even if there is a gun in my hand and he stands in front of me, I will not shoot. This is the compassion I have learned from Muhammad, the Prophet of Mercy, Jesus Christ, and Lord Buddha. This is the legacy of change I have inherited from Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and Muhammad Ali Jinnah. This is the philosophy of nonviolence I have learned from Gandhi Ji, Baka Khan, and Mother Teresa. This is the forgiveness I have learned from my mother and father. This is what my soul is telling me. Be peaceful and love everyone. The wise saying, the pen is mightier than the sword, was true. The extremists are afraid of books and pens. The power of education frightens them. They are afraid of women. And that is why they killed 14 innocent students in the recent attack in Qatar. That is why they are blasting schools every day. Because they were and are afraid of change. Afraid of the equality we'll bring to our society. Dear fellows, today I'm focusing on women's rights and girls' education, because that is what's suffering the most. There was a time when women social activists asked men to stand up for our rights, but this time we will do it ourselves. I'm not telling men to step away from speaking on women's rights. Rather, I'm focusing on women to be independent and fight for themselves. Dear brothers and sisters, we want schools and education for every child's bright future. So let us wage a global struggle against illiteracy, poverty, and terrorism, and let us pick up our books and pens. They are our most powerful weapon. One child, one teacher, one book, one pen can change the world. Education is our only solution. Education first.
Hello, I'm Anne Brian Burdett, and I'm going to be doing Charlie Chaplin's speech. I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone, if possible, Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there is room for everyone. The good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical. Our cleverness, hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The airplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for the universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world, millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish.
My name is Brittany Bossidy, and I will be doing the Gettysburg Address. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us living, rather, to be here dedicated to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. And that nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom. And that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from that earth.
Hello. Hello, my name is Nolan Harper, and I'm doing Charlie Chaplin. I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone, if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate or despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goosed up us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives us abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness of men, cries out for the universal brotherhood and the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world. Millions of despairing men, women, and little children. Victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass, the dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And as long as men die, liberty will never perish.
God.
Hello, my name is Ezra Wilson, and this is the Gettysburg Address. 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth onto this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. We are now engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow these grounds, because the brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be here dedicated to this unfinished work that they who fought here have thus so far nobly advanced. It is for us to rather be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion, for they here gave their last full measure of devotion, that we highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, that the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from earth.
Hi, I'm Kara Dutton, and I'm doing Charlie Chaplin. I'm sorry, but I don't want to be an emperor. That is not my business. I do not want to rule or conquer anyone. I just like to help everyone. If possible, Jew, Gentile, black man, white, we all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's soul, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for the universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world, millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass and dictators die. The power they took from the people will return to the people. So long as men die, liberty will never perish.
My name is Devin Coleman, and I'm doing the Gettysburg Address. 87 years ago, Our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equally. Now engage in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation, so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure on that great battlefield of that war, to come to get dedicate to the proposition that all men come to get dedicate. Dedicate. Can long ago we are met on the great battlefield of the war to dedicate a proportion of that field as a final resting place for those who fought for that nation might live. Is all fitting and proper that we should do this? But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated far above our power to add or detract. The world will no longer remember what we say here, but will never forget what they did here. It's all fitting and proper that we should do this, but in a large way. The world will no longer remember what we say here, but will never forget what we did here. It's rather for us living to dedicate to unfinished work, which they who fought here fought so nobly in advancement. It's rather for us to dedicate to the great task remaining before us, that from these on our dead, we take increased devotion, which they gave their last full measures of devotion. That we highly resolve that these men shall not have died in vain. And the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're actually a little bit ahead of schedule, which is great. We're going to give you a solid 5-minute break. Get a drink, go to the bathroom, do what you need to do. 5-minute break. If I could have students kind of make their way up here. Thank you. No, we're not doing the Macarena. We need to take pictures.
growing strong.
Ladies and gentlemen, if we could have a seat, please. I believe I said a hard five, and I think we went over our hard five, so I apologize for that. Many of you might be aware of when the Mesa bus is a-rockin', there's always a good chance we are serenading Mrs. Louie and singing Sweet Caroline. So always nice to do that. Thank you so much. I hope everybody's all set. A little reminder about your phone to make sure that you've turned it on to vibrate. We're going to continue with our second half of our speeches, and we begin with Darlene Snyder.
Hello, my name is Darlene Snyder, and I will be doing the Queen Elizabeth speech to the Spanish Armada. My loving people, we've been persuaded by some who are careful of our safety, who take heed of how we commit ourselves to armed multitudes, for fear of treachery. But I assure you, I do not desire to live in a world to distrust my faithful and loving people. Let tyrants fear. I've always so behaved myself that under God, I place my chief of strength, my safeguard, and the loyal hearts and goodwill of my subjects. And that is why I come amongst you. As you see, at this time, not for my recreation and disport, but being resolved in the midst and the heat of the battle. To live and to die amongst you all, to lay down for my God, my kingdom, my honor, and my blood, even in the dust. I know I may have the body, but of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and the stomach of a king, and the King of England too. And to think foul scorn that Parm or Spain or any prince of Europe should dare to invade the borders of my realm, that should bring great dishonor against me. But I myself will take up arms. I myself will be your general judge and rewarder of all of your virtues in the field. That is why I come amongst you, as you see, at this time, not for my recreation and disport, but being resolved in the midst and the heat of the battle, to live and to die amongst you all, to lay down for my God, my kingdom, my honor, and my blood, even in the dust. I have the body but of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the stomach and the heart of a king, and the King of England too. To think foul scorn that Parm or Spain or any prince of Europe should dare to invade the borders of my realm, that should bring great dishonor against me. But I myself will take up arms. I myself will be a general judge and warder of all of your virtues in the field. I already know for your forwardness you have deserved rewards and crowns, but I do assure you, in the word of a prince, they shall be duly paid to you. In the meantime, my lieutenant general shall be in my stead, than whom never a prince committed a more noble or worthy subject. Not doubting by your obedience to my general, by your coordinates in the camp, and your victories in the field. We shall shortly have a famous victory over those enemies of my God, my kingdom, and of my people.
Okay, it's on. I'm Cy Stevens. I'm in eighth grade. So, the past couple of years have been really, really hard. We've witnessed a virus which has taken and misshapen lives. We've had a horrible war with no meaning but power. Terrible shootings have taken the lives of children at schools. Droughts have led to wildfires. Inflation and rising oil prices have driven people into living in the cold. With all of this, it's easy to get down. It's easy to think that the world has nothing good. But that's not true. We need to be grateful. We need to be happy for the good things. It makes us feel better, and it's easy. So why don't we do it? Everybody can be grateful for something. What are you guys grateful for? Anyone? Anne? Avery? Kara? Mila? So, this is a granola bar. Everybody here has probably had this, or something like it, right? It's nothing special. Yet the ingredients in this granola bar have traveled thousands of miles to get here, to me. The low monetary value on this has made it, has turned this into a mindless snack. But it's not. We're so lucky to have things like this that we don't even think about it. We take them for granted. The news can also keep us from being grateful. When we see stories of horrible, horrible things going on in the world that we're attracted to, because it's our brain, how our brains work, that's what we think. That's how we operate. When we watch horror movies, we start to think that the world is all murders and clowns living in sewers. But it's not that way. It's all a flip of a switch. It's mental. And just like all mental things, it can be conquered. We need to be grateful. If we're more grateful, we'll be more happy. And remember, in the granola bar, in the metaphorical granola bar of life, be sure to be grateful for the bites.
Hi, my name is Dante Cabaneo, and I'm doing Martin Luther King Jr. I Have a Dream. I'm happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. I'm not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom left you battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You have been veterans of creative suffering. Continue to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi, go back to Alabama, go back to South Carolina, go back to Georgia, go back to Louisiana, go back to the slums and ghettos of our northern cities, knowing how somehow this situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in this valley of despair. I say to you today, my friends, so even though we face these difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in an American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out its true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day, down in Alabama, with its vicious racist, with its governor having his lips dripping the words of interposition and nullification, one day, in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, every hill and mountain shall be made low, and the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together.
Hi, my name is Asa Dickinson. I'm in eighth grade, and I have written my own speech. Everyone's a winner, right? Everyone's just as good at one thing than anybody else. Does that sound familiar? Because it should. That's our world today. I hate it. I think it's stupid, and there's no point. That's how I feel about it. Not saying that's how you should feel. It's my opinion. No need to get offended. I'm 14 years old, and in those 14 years, I've seen this. Our world changing in just 14 years, and not in a good way. Now let's go back in our time machines. Kindergarten and first grade, not much competition to behold, right? You can barely draw inside the lines. After that, second, third, fourth grade, you start sports. And that alone boosts competitiveness. But school sports competitiveness hasn't gone down. It's things inside of school, like music, PE, or art that's gone down. Now, for those of you who don't know, I stink at anything art. And last year, I got straight threes. Didn't make sense to me, considering I can barely draw a stick figure correctly. Last year, I was stumped in what to draw, so I drew a polar bear in a snowstorm. For those of you who don't know what that is, it is a white dot in the middle of a white piece of paper. Know what my grade was? A 4 for creativity. Does that seem fair to the people who are drawing beautiful landscapes? I don't think so. Now, in 2 to 3 years at this school, I've seen one thing go down in competition significantly, and that's the turkey trot. For those of you who don't know what the turkey trot is, it used to be a race. The fastest person would get a turkey. Now, my sixth grade year, it wasn't much of a turkey trot because of COVID. But my seventh and eighth grade year, it was a participation turkey trot. In other words, a raffle. Say you did 5 laps. That would be 5 tickets. 5 tickets in a raffle would sound pretty good, right? You would think so. There's many people that did at least 5 laps, and they got nothing. Does that seem fair to them? They tried their hardest and got nothing? I don't think so. This year, I finished the lap the fastest. You know what I got? A piece of paper with my printed name on it saying congratulations. That lasted about 2 days, then it ended up in our trash. Now, for those of you who think I'm just down talking to school, you're partially right. But I want to try to help it. Instead of everybody gets a trophy, how about the top 3 people, or even top 5 people? Or is that so much too much competition for you? And if it is, then be asking yourself, why participate, why push yourself, and why try?
Okay. Hello, my name is Hannah, and I will be doing the Gettysburg Address. I'm also in sixth grade. Poor score, and 7 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all people are created equal. Now, we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation, so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war, and we have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here give their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a large sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, and that government and this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom. And that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth.
Hello, my name is Winter Dyer Mirbeck, and I'm in eighth grade. Let me start off by saying that life is unpredictable. In seventh grade, I started questioning life. Why are we here? What is the point? My parents were my saving grace, teaching me how to cope with those feelings and showing me the point of life. For me, it's to be happy and enjoy every single moment. I remember when my dad woke me up one morning and I asked him, "Why do I have to get up?" And without hesitation, he answered, "To spread your love, light, and energy." And something in my mind switched. I realized that life is not what you accomplish and not what you do perfectly. I know the teachers are always asking, what is the legacy that you are leaving behind? Which means, when you leave middle school, is there a certain message that you leave that represents something for the next generation of Mesa students? I'm still trying to figure out what mine is, but I do want to leave behind an important message. Maybe the speech has nothing to do with the legacy that I leave behind, but I do want people knowing that life shouldn't be a race to be the best or trying to be better than the others around you. Sometimes the news, work, things you must do, and life in general can get you down. Stress. We constantly have stress. Sometimes you can feel like you're going in circles. The point of life can be unclear. Sometimes it feels like a never-ending cycle. The ennui of existence can become a bore. Lots of us search for something to fill us up. That missing piece, I constantly do that. Look forward to things, thinking that once they happen, I'll be happy. But then afterwards, I'm left with an empty feeling. This is why we all need to realize that life, nothing outside of ourselves can fill us up. It comes from within. No items, money, or even clothing. Being a person with kindness and integrity and living with compassion for yourself and others, that can fulfill you. So to me, you shouldn't spend life searching for that missing piece because it doesn't exist outside of yourself. The point of life is to embrace mistakes and keep moving forward. Mesa is very important to me, but it's also important to life. The things we learn don't just apply to schoolwork, but there are valuable life lessons taught. Some of my favorite moments are when we are completely disorganized after an outing, laughing in the snow during lunch, or getting to meet with insanely intelligent and interesting people. Maybe 40% of our week isn't spent in-class lessons, but we learn about real life, real-world problems, and things that actually apply to life in this world. And that can be sometimes more important than any other class. In life, things happen, and part of life is to accept those obstacles. In February of 2022, my father had a subarachnoid hemorrhage, which means a bleeding in the brain. The survival rate is 25% and usually are dead within the first 24 hours, with or without medical attention. My father survived. And as you can imagine, that was the biggest relief in the world for me. But it also changed a lot of things. Though life was hard and we had to adapt to life being different, it did change my outlook on life. And as my father told me, life is short and we need to take chances. As a friend once said, compared to everything that exists in our world and in our universe, we are just tiny grains of sand. But if that's what we are, why not try to be happy? The real point of this speech is just to say that in my view, the point of life is to be in the moment at all times and love every second of it. Love yourself, and we're all in the same boat, so why aren't we working together? Be happy and smile back.
Hi, I'm Peter Priestman, and I'll be doing the Spanish Armada. My loving people, we have been persuaded by some that are careful of our safety to take heed of how we commit ourselves to armed multitudes for fear of treachery. But I assure you, I do not desire to live to distrust my faithful and loving people. I have always so behaved myself that under God, I place the chiefest strength and safehold in the loyal hearts of my subjects. And therefore, I am come amongst you today, as you see, at this time, not for my recreation and disport, but for being resolved in the heat and midst of battle, to live and die amongst you all, to lay down for my God and for my kingdom, for my people, my honor, and my blood, even in the dust. I know I have the body of but a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a king of England too, and think foul scorn of Parma or Spain, or any such prince of Europe that dares to invade the borders of my realm, to which any dishonor shall grow by me. I myself will take up in arms. I will be your general, your judge, and rewarder of every single one of your virtues in the field. I know already for your forwardness you have deserved rewards and crowns, and we do assure you, in the words of a prince, that that will be duly paid to you, and the lieutenant general shall be in my stead, than whom never prince commanded more noble or worthy subject, not doubting by your obedience to my general, by your conquered in the camp, and your valor in the field, we will shortly have a famous victory over those enemies of my God, of my kingdom, and of my people.
Hello, my name is Maya Johnson. I'll be doing Charlie Chaplin. I'm sorry, but I do not want to be an emperor. That is not my business. I do not want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone, if possible. Jew, Gentile, black men, white. We should all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We do not want to hate and despise one another. This world has room for everyone, and the good earth can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful. We've lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate,
has goosed us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed. We have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical. Our cleverness, hard and unkind. We think too much, and we feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent, and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio has brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men cries, for the universal of brotherhood, for the unity of us all, even now. My voice is reaching millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress, the hate of men will pass, and dictators die. And the power they took from the people returned to the people. As long as men die, liberty will never perish.
Success is not final. Failure is not fatal. It is the courage to continue that counts. Winston Churchill. Hi, my name is Cassidy Jordan, and I'm in eighth grade. I've been thinking for a while about what my eighth grade speech will be about, and I've decided to do something that is important to me, something that comes up in my life a lot. This is perseverance and staying positive. Perseverance may be something you think about all the time, or it's never crossed your mind. Either way, everyone has to persevere in life to get anything done. Perseverance is the persistence in doing something despite difficulties or delays in achieving success. But how do we do that? Well, first off, you need inspiration and a goal to work towards, along with motivation to get yourself there. And this is what my speech is about. When I was younger, I always wanted Christmas every single day. But the older I get, the more I realize this isn't something I would want. It would ruin that one special day of the year that kids and adults look forward to months beforehand. My favorite thing on Christmas is when me and my little sister, Avery, wait on top of the stairs for our parents to let us come down. We practically trample each other running down the stairs to look at the Christmas tree and the presents underneath. Christmas, for most people, is a huge high point in the year. But if it was every day, it would ruin that one special day of the year. So maybe your inspiration is getting to Christmas, the weekend or summer break, and to have some time to relax and appreciate life. To spend time with your family and friends. This is an example of inspiration. Christmas can inspire you to persevere through the hard times and to get to your goal. Inspiration ties into perseverance because it is one of the many things that keeps you going and gives you the motivation you need. Life is 10% what happens to you and 90% how you react to it. Charles Swindoll. Everyone here has probably heard of the famous yin and yang sign. It represents the good and the bad, and the bad and the good. This ties into staying positive. Even when things are not the best, it's all mental and how you look at it. Is the cup half full or half empty? It's your choice. Sports are something that mean a lot to me. Last year was my first year of middle school softball. I have always been a pitcher and just pitched underhand. I wasn't strong enough to windmill pitch. Once I was in middle school, everyone was so far ahead of me, and only a few pitchers were underhand pitching like I was. I was determined to teach myself how to windmill pitch. With help from my mom, coach, and a couple YouTube videos, along with hours of practice, I was ready to try in a game. This is an example of perseverance. So just remember, You cannot control what happens to you, but you can control your attitude towards what happens to you. And in that, you will be mastering change rather than allowing it to master you. Brian Tracy. When we as humans can push through tough challenges, that makes us a step closer to achieving our goals. It makes it so anything is possible.
I'm Danny Pelkey, doing Gettysburg. 84 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation, so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives, that that nation might live. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow these grounds. The brave men, living and dead, who have consecrated far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus so far nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to the cause for which they gave their last full measure of devotion, that we highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and the government by the people, of the people, for the people, shall not perish from earth.
Hi, my name is Ava Lounsbury, and I'm doing my own speech. Unlike my sister, who was born talking, I was a late talker. As my sister tells me the story, when I was 2 years old, no one could understand what I was saying. Only very repetitive things were translated. One of them was "Hi, Diddy." I spoke to Diddy by standing on the couch, looking in the mirror. No one really knew what it meant. One time, my mom asked me what I was saying, and I told her I was talking to Diddy. My family then later realized I was talking to my reflection, and I was saying "Hi, pretty." As it turned out, I needed speech therapy. So in first grade, I went to speech services, where I learned to say words like yellow, not lello, school, not tool, spoon, not poon, and skunk, not conk. When I started speech therapy, I thought I was special because this nice lady who happened to be a speech pathologist wanted to play games with me. I later realized she was hanging out with me because I couldn't talk. If you all can understand me, shout out to Missing Finger. Fast forward 7 years to completely different speech problems. I'm in eighth grade and I've been assigned a particular assignment that's very difficult. And after listening to 2 years of eighth grade speeches, I'm wondering why. Why do we have to do this? While I understand it's important to be able to find your voice, be social, and be confident with public speaking formally in front of big audiences. However, when I take a step back, sometimes I think there's too much emphasis on speaking and not enough on listening. There are so many apps where we just post comments like Instagram, Facebook, and many more. But what about the importance of listening? Some might think talking is more important than listening, but I ask you this. Why were we born with two mouths and one ear?
Why were we born with one mouth and two ears? Perhaps it's because we're supposed to do twice as much listening as speaking. Listening builds trust. Without listening, how are you supposed to trust? If no one listens to what you have to say, how are you supposed to build a healthy relationship? How are you supposed to be open and confident? Listening helps you have adventures. Listening takes you to places you might never be able to go. Listening helps you undergo experiences you would never have otherwise. It enables you to stay connected to things happening around you. Listening increases your productivity. Take Mesa students. We have to take a lot of listening quizzes. There are speakers we have to listen to on our trips, and we have to listen a lot. But this is how we ask good questions and learn and grow. Personally, I think listening is more important than speaking. Although the speech is about the value of listening, we all have the responsibility of speaking as well. Perhaps Gandhi says it best. We cannot be speakers who do not listen, but neither can we be listeners who do not speak. Thank you all for listening.
My name is Claire McDougall, and I'm doing the speech by Queen Elizabeth I. My loving people, we have been persuaded by some that are careful of our safety to take heed of how we commit ourselves to armed multitudes for fear of treachery. But I assure you, I do not desire to live to distrust my faithful and loving people. Let tyrants fear. I have always so behaved myself that under God, I have placed my chiefest strength and safeguard in the loyal hearts and goodwill of my subjects. And therefore, I am come amongst you. As you see, at this time, not for my recreation and disport, but being resolved, in the heat and midst of the battle, to live and die amongst you all, to lay down for my God and my kingdom and my people, honor and blood, even in the dust. I know I have the body, but of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a king of England too. And think foul scorn that Parma or Spain or any prince of Europe dares to invade the borders of my realms, to which rather have than any dishonor shall grow by me. I myself will take up arms. I myself will be your general judge and rewarder of every one of your virtues in the field. I know already, for your forwardness, that you have deserved rewards and crowns. And in the words of a prince, they shall be duly paid you. In the meantime, my lieutenant general shall be in my stead, than whom never prince commanded a more noble or worthy subject. Not by doubting, but by your obedience to my general, your conquered in the camp, and your valor in the field, that we shall shortly have a famous victory over those enemies of my God and my kingdom and my people.
Hi, I'm Tenley Cousins, and I will be doing the Gettysburg Address. 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty, and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, assessing whether that nation, or any nation, so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of this field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who have struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will no longer remember what we say here, but it can never forget what we did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be here, dedicated to the unfinished work which those who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here, dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. We highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the sword.
Hi, my name is Solana Manning, and I'm doing a speech by Malala. Dear friends, on the 9th of October, 2012, the Taliban shot me on the left side of my forehead. They shot my friends too. They thought that the bullets would silence us, but they failed. And then, out of the silence, came thousands of voices. The terrorists thought that they could change our aims and stop our ambitions. But nothing changed in my life except this. Weakness, fear, and hopelessness died. Strength, power, and courage were born. I am the same Malala. My ambitions are the same, my hopes are the same, and my dreams are the same. I do not even hate the Talib who shot me. Even if there is a gun in my hand and he stands in front of me, I would not shoot him. This is the compassion I have learnt from Muhammad, the Prophet of Mercy, Jesus Christ, and Lord Buddha. This is the legacy of change I have inherited from Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and Muhammad Ali Jinnah. This is the philosophy of nonviolence that I have learned from Gandhi G, Baraka Khan, and Mother Teresa. And this is the forgiveness I have learned from my mother and my father. This is what my soul is telling me. Be peaceful and love everyone. The wise saying, the pen is mightier than the sword, was true. The extremists are afraid of books and pens. The power of education frightens them. They're afraid of women. The power of the voice of women frightens them. And that is why they killed 14 innocent medical students in the recent attack in Quetta. That is why they are blasting schools every day. Because they were and they are afraid of the change and afraid of the equality that we will bring to our society. Dear fellows, today I am focusing on women's rights and girls' education because they are suffering the most. There was a time when women's social activists asked men to stand up for their rights. But this time, we'll do it ourselves. I'm not telling men to step away from speaking on women's rights. Rather, I am focusing on women to be independent and fight for themselves. Dear brothers and sisters, we want schools and education for every child's bright future. So let us wage a global struggle against illiteracy, poverty, and terrorism. And let us pick up our books and pens. They are our most powerful weapon. One child, one teacher, one book, one pen can change the world. Education is the only solution. Education first.
Anyone name the song that just played? That's it. Some of you, I think that song's a good one. You might feel more connected to the people around you that also know that song. For others, it might spark a memory. Hi, my name is John Cowan. And that song brings me back to one of the first songs I learned on the bass. This song has inspired me to be the musician I am today. I play in the 7th, 8th grade band, the middle school rock band Kajemo, my youth group worship band, and recently I joined the Mount Washington Valley Community Band. The main reason why I do these things is because they're fun and I'm good at it. Music can do a whole lot more than just being something that's fun. It can make you happy, energized, and maybe a little sad too. I know when I'm listening to Kickstart My Heart before a football game with my dad, I feel ready to go and ready to knock someone flat. When I listen to music around the house, it makes me happy. But music connects us, makes us have feelings. Take the guitar, for example. We all know what this is. This well-recognized instrument was made in the 15th century in Spain, but yet most countries have their own version of it. Mexican jarana jaroca, the South American charango, the Hawaiian steel guitar, the chitarra italiana, the Greek mouzouki, the Japanese shamisen. These are all stringed instruments. All these different cultures and countries have something in common. That is the stringed instrument. Music is a powerful tool that can bring individuals together, promote trust, empathy, and relieve stress. When we dance and sing together, there's a sense of community, with everyone moving together with shared intentions and a mutual goal. I'm sure everyone here, as a kid, had very different tastes in music than your parents did. You use these tastes in music to bond with other kids your age and make them your friends. But music can also make you have feelings. When you're watching a movie, that movie takes control of your feelings with the music in it. When it's a sad dog movie, it's part of the movie where the dog dies. That movie plays really slow, soft notes to make you feel sad. When it's a happy, joyous movie, that movie plays really loud, high, fast notes to make you feel happy. Next time you listen to someone speak, listen to the characteristics of their voice. They mirror the music with the same emotion. Fast, loud, and high for excitement and happiness, but slower and softer for talking sad. Music is a way to express feelings that might be hard to express otherwise. Helps us calm down or just relax on a bad day. But on a good day, music just helps us get through the day. As Johnny Depp once said, music touches us emotionally where words alone can't. Thank you.
Be performing Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech. I'm happy to join with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. I am not unmindful that some of you have come here out of great trials and tribulations. Some of you have come fresh from narrow jail cells. Some of you have come from areas where your quest for freedom left you battered by the storms of persecution and staggered by the winds of police brutality. You've been veterans of created suffering. Continue to work with the faith that unearned suffering is redemptive. Go back to Mississippi. Go back to Alabama. Go back to South Carolina. Go back to Georgia. Go back to Louisiana. Go back to the slums and ghettos of our northern cities, knowing that somehow this situation can and will be changed. Let us not wallow in the valley of despair. I say to you today, my friends, so even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even in the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification. One day there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will join hand in hand with the little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain will be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to fight for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to join, will be able to sing with new meaning. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, then this must become true. And so let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that. Let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Hi, my name is Oren Monteith, and I wrote my own speech. Children are our future, right? Well, the past of how students have been taught in school has a very dark side to it. Public schools were originally made to teach kids just enough that they could work in giant factories and create money for already wealthy people, but not so much that they are creative and independent that they'll become the competitors of those companies. This was the start of the American public school system. To the unknowing people, this seemed amazing. Free school for all kids, right? This was such a good idea because people like John D. Rockefeller, who needed workers to maintain his empire, could teach them to be whatever he wanted them to be. At this age, kids' brains are still developing, so teaching them works very well. He could decide what and what not to teach, and that following others is more important than thinking for yourself. Rockefeller quotes, "I don't want a nation of thinkers. I want a nation of workers." In other words, he just wants slaves who just get the job done on a very low salary. This should all be fine now because it's been two centuries and it should have all changed, right? No. Other than things like discipline, school hasn't changed much since the 19th century. All traditional classes that are taught now were taught back then. For example, in 1845, you would have had classes like reading, spelling, history, arithmetic, which are all taught now. Why don't we have classes at a very early age that teach teamwork and working with other kids and helping and learning together from the very start? Then, in later years, why don't schools teach you skills you would need nowadays, like using technology to your advantage, how to be safe and productive online, how to make money early on, and just overall life skills? Social studies should actually be social studies, not history, where you learn about the problems in the world and how so many creative people are working to fix those problems. Students should have more of a choice what classes they take, and schools should be able to adapt to make new classes that students want to learn. Because even if it's something like video game design, students are still wanting to learn. Our school system now is making students less intelligent. For example, kindergartners through second or third graders are eager to learn, whereas almost no middle schooler wants to learn anything. Close your eyes and think. What do young kids ask that older people or older kids would almost never ask? Think. They ask why. Asking why is such a great question because it shows you that you're interested and curious for knowledge, even though that it can be annoying sometimes. Can you remember a little sibling? Why? When have you ever heard a middle schooler ask why? A big part of this is that they have been through 5 to 6 years of school, and while their academic knowledge has increased, their creativity and creative knowledge and their ability to think of outside of the box has decreased. Our education system needs to change. Not in 20 years, it needs to change now. Because kids should be able to be taught, it needs to change now, because kids should not be taught the same way they were taught 2 whole centuries ago. That's 200 years. Should move on from the dark past of education and should focus on skills that are needed now, not skills that are from hundreds of years ago, just to work factory machines. Students should be taught that they can control what they do in life, not that they can only follow others. I have one final question. Is it right that the majority of school is telling students that they can't even control their own life?
All right, thank you very much. Can we give a huge round of applause to all our students today? Yay! All right. And I got caught up during my introduction. I totally apologize. Now at this time, my amazing judges who have offered their time to come tonight and be a part of this event, Mike Dufalo of Tin Mountain. Yes. Hi, Mike! Miss Patty Friedman. Coach Bob Mallon. And former student Soleil Quantel. And of course, our superintendent, Jay Robinson. Thank you so much. We're going to take a brief break in my room, and we'll be back in a little bit. Thank you so much.
not here.
I was right here. And
I actually have the photo.
Avery Jordan, there's a step stool under here.
Yeah. I know. She knows.
She could have used it.
Guys, this is a good exercise.
Silly faces.
Guys, everyone wait. I need to get my mom to take one. Stay. Stay. Everybody stay.
Everybody stay.
Hunter, stay.
Ollie.
Hunter, go back out here.
We're taking another one.
Wait, is this a silly one?
No.
Guys, let's do a normal one.
Yeah.
Silly photo.
We're doing this.
Never mind.
Oh, she's coming.
Never mind.
Guys.
Silly face!
Avery. Ew! I don't want her next to me.
Silly face!
She's gone.
Darlene!
Your lipstick's on.
Darlene.
They had a stool?
I know, that's what I said. Avery could have used it.
Avery!
Take a picture of Ollie.
Jordan!
My, she knows. Take a picture of Ollie.
Yes.
Wait, give me.
Ah! Oh my God. only buttons? But you have multiple? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
We don't. We don't talk about that.
Oh, dog!
The big reveal, yes. If you're wondering where we were, think about the task that we had. And then you'd be, oh, that makes about sense. My gosh, the discussions that we've had, I cannot in any way thank the judges enough. And thank you parents enough for supporting your children. I don't know how many times you heard their speech. Probably some of you could already do the speech for them right now. So thank you so much. So without further ado, because I'm sure it's starting to get late, we'd like to go home. I will announce who won. But in a surprise, we are going to make it, and I know Asa, you're not going to like this. Everybody won, Asa. Okay. We do speech night not because you place. We don't do speech night because you get your name on my wall. If you go in my classroom, everybody from year one to where we are now, their name is on the wall of the people that place. Great. It's not about that. It's about overcoming. It's about doing something that is impossible. Maddie mentioned the giant's ladder. That's a structure that's probably at least 30 feet tall. The gaps on the ladder are about 7 feet tall. It is an impossible proposition for anyone at all. But that being said, it makes it possible. How do I know this? Because Avery Jordan over there went to the top, not with the help of somebody else. Somebody else helped her out for a little ways, and then she did, what, 75% of that all by yourself? Ladies and gentlemen, the impossible is possible, and you guys show it tonight. So hats off to you. One more round of applause. Hey! All right. There were many names mentioned tonight. But that being said, in sixth grade, third place goes to Bryson Lounsbury. All right. Second place goes to Brittany Bossidy. And first place goes to Avery Jordan. All right, thank you so much. In seventh grade, third place goes to Solana Manning. Second place goes to Maya Johnson. And first place goes to Sam McDonald. This is your last speech night. Third place goes to Winter Dyer Mirbeck. Second place goes to John Callen. And first place goes to Aver Lounsbury. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Thank you. May you have a good night. Drive safe.